I want to welcome the entire Grow family and our Grow family all across the world. Welcome. We pray that you leave today challenged and changed because of the power of the Word of God. From the moment you step in to the moment you leave, it is a house of prayer and praise and preaching. To show them His love, tell them His truth, teach them His ways.
Today's the day, Grove Church. Today is the day. BWE is starting, and we're so excited. Would y'all stand and praise the Lord with us this morning?
I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, I'll praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when I'm numb. As long as I'm breathing.
worshiping and praising the Lord, for He is good. Come on, let's sing.
I'll praise because you're sovereign. Praise because you reign. Praise because you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise because you're faithful. Praise because you're true. Praise because there's nobody greater than you.
Come on.
I'll praise because you're sovereign. Praise because you reign.
Make this Lift that up all across the room this morning.
All my life you have been faithful.
Yes, you have.
All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm seeing close. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I live in the goodness of God. Yeah, all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so.
Pray to him right now. Give him praise in your heart. Give him praise. He is worthy of praise. What this week has the Father showed you? What this week has the Father proven to you that he is faithful? Give him praise. Be quick to praise him. Be quick to praise our Lord. All my life he has been faithful. All my life he has been so faithful. So good. Just praise him. Just praise him. Lord Jesus, how can we not pause to praise you? For this is a house of prayer and praise and preaching. You have heard our praise. Lord, I pray that in the quietness of this moment, in this room, and all watching all over the world, that praise would do a soul good today. That it would be good, as the psalmist says, to praise you by day because of your faithfulness by day and night. Lord, thank you that you are worthy of praise. Lord, I pray if there is someone here that is unsure if they have a personal relationship with you, the Father of creation, the Holy One, that today they would confess their sin and say, I'm sorry, I believe you are the only one that can save me. Thank you for coming to this world and taking my sin upon the cross, God. Thank you for rising again. Save me. May they learn of the beautiful care and protection that you give your children. Lord, for those of us that have given our lives and hearts to you, I just want to say thank you. Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness, your faithfulness that we have sung about all morning. You are so, so good. So good. With your heads bowed in a moment, Josh, we would just sing that chorus again. All my life you have been faithful. And just sing it as a prayer to the Heavenly Father, if you would. And just praise him.
So all my life you have been faithful. So all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I'm able, oh, I'll sing of the goodness of God.
All my life you have been faithful. Sing it again. Sing it with him.
So all my life you have been faithful.
Sing it to the Lord.
Yes, Lord, all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I am singing of the goodness of God.
Lord, I pray today that as we open this portion of your word, we leave encouraged by your care and love for us, and that we will never forget the goodness of God. I pray today that my speech and preaching be not of enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that our faith would not stand in the wisdom of a man, but in the power of God. We love you. We praise you this day. For you are worthy of praise in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Let's praise him this morning. He is worthy of our praise. We praise him this morning. Praise be to God. We are so excited to approach God's word today. If you have your phones, go ahead and pull up Luke chapter 12. If you have your Bibles, Luke chapter 12, a wonderful portion of scripture. And as you are doing that, let me remind you of the obvious. Tonight, we minister to the children of our church and the children of the Richmond metro area. Tonight, beginning 6:15 sharp, we start our wonderful time of ministry to the children of this community. I am so, so excited. The doors will open at 5:45. Many of you have registered. We'll need you to check in. And then at 6:15, all the prayer, all the planning, all of the fasting and praying over the ministry to our children begins. We have many people. We had like six kids register overnight. We expect you can certainly register at the door. You can register right now on our website, groveav.com/BWE. You can actually register on the QR code in front of you. We will accept you. We will turn no one away. And we are so excited. I am so excited to be able to join the kids as we worship together. And then me and my buddy Matt Sutton, we get to go downstairs and do the Bible studies with them and act like bigger kids ourselves. And then we come up and they're going to meet new friends, have positive peer pressure. It's such an exciting time. Tonight, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then on Thursday, every single person is invited to come where we celebrate a wonderful week of pointing them to Christ, and the sky will fall Thursday. So you do not want to miss that. Last year, we only had 5 of these hot dog nets. Now we have 8. And it's funny, I was just looking up, and there's a piece of paper up in that one, and it's actually the manual on how to set it up. So maybe that's what we needed. I don't know. So it's up there. And, you know, you just open it up and throw away the manual. We found it. It's right there. So that, I'm not lying. It's actually the manual. Happy Father's Day on behalf of everyone from the Grove family to your family. Happy Father's Day. We are so, so excited that you have chosen to celebrate with us and join your family. I have met a lot of fathers that have come with their sons, members of the Grove family. And I just, on behalf of the Grove family, I want to welcome you and say Happy Father's Day. This is a very special day. Happy Father's Day to my father, upstate Michigan, and all the fathers. Just way to go for joining us right here in church and pointing everyone in your family to the Lord. This is the best place to be on Father's Day. And what a great opportunity to launch our ministry to our children on Father's Day. We are so excited. We call this the best week ever because we believe that souls will be saved, lives will be changed, kids will meet new friends. Whatever school they go to, they will know that they have a church house where they can come and meet Christian friends and hopefully create friendships for a lifetime. And that truly is the best week ever, and it starts on Father's Day. It's wonderful. We have a very, very special Father's Day announcement. You know, many of our Grove family, young couples have come to the Grove Church, and it's no surprise that our preschool over the last year or so has just grown because young families are adding to our numbers, and we're so happy. We have, of course, part of our team, our leadership team, and our youth pastor, Chad and Emily. They have announced the birth of their brand new baby girl. She is a beautiful miracle of God. Her name is Psalm. What a beautiful name, beautiful miracle. You know she's going to be a singer. You know she is going to be on this stage. So trust me, the first moment she can articulate a syllable, she is right up here on stage. And of course, mom and dad are going to bawl their eyes out and not be able to get through the song, but little Psalm is an absolute miracle of God. We have prayed over this little one. We have prayed over their journey, and the Lord just brought her our way, and we are so, so grateful. We were celebrating with them just yesterday, and it reminded me of a portion of my favorite psalm, Psalm 139. You made all the delicate inward parts of my body. You've knitted me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous, how well I know it. You've watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion. And as I was woven together in the darkness of my mother's womb, you saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day has passed. How precious are your thoughts unto me, O God. How great are the sum of them. If I should count them, they are more than number than the sand. And every morning I awake, I know I am still with you. Amen. Tonight, when we minister to the children of this church, we are not just working, we are worshiping. We are looking at God's creation, the beautiful birth of children and parents that have put the children under our care. And we are not just laboring to the point of exhaustion. We are doing it because it has a deeper purpose. The Lord cares about children, and so should we. Praise be to God. You have your phones. It's open to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12 is a beautiful passage as we continue our series on Hush the Hurry. This is a collection of messages that we started a couple weeks ago, and it's very appropriate for the month of June. So if you're just joining us, I want to catch you up and let you know where we as a family are studying God's Word. It's very, very practical. Hush the Hurry is about not denying that there is busyness. In fact, the world, just even the scriptures describe how we should work hard, and there's a lot of laboring sometimes to the point of exhaustion. So we're not here today and coming to church for a kind of a time management seminar. You can go buy those and download those. But what we're doing is we're approaching scripture on how to hush the hurry. In the midst of busyness, which we all are, month of June's probably the busiest with changing school schedules and all of that, We are asking the Lord, how should I go through my day and remain strong, spiritually strong in a busy world? And we have found from Scripture, this being the third week, that you and I can remain spiritually strong in a busy world. 2 weeks ago, we talked about Luke chapter 10 that set the stage where Martha was preparing dinner for the Lord. Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus. She was once in the kitchen helping with Martha and making dinner, and then she came and sat at the feet of Jesus. Martha came out of the kitchen and said, "Jesus, tell her to help me." She thought she'd get an affirmative answer. And like you saw her leave, and you need to get her back in the kitchen. Martha was doing a good thing, was making dinner for the God himself in her living room. But she was surprised by Jesus' answer and said, "No, Martha, Martha, you are troubled and anxious about many things." So the word was stressed. You're very stressed. I can see the outward expression. I can see your inward battle about many things. But Martha, what Mary is doing right now is necessary. She has chosen the better, the wiser decision, the better portion. In fact, I was sharing with the staff that week that we didn't have time to go over in the service, but when the Lord said she has chosen the, quote, better part, the better portion, it's actually the Greek word for a portion of the meal. In other words, you're preparing a meal, but she's chosen to consume the better part of this meal, the communion part. And then he said, this is necessary. She's chosen the better portion. And third, what she's doing will never leave her memory, will never depart from her. And as a church, we said, what did you do in ministry 8 weeks ago? And we're like, And then I said, would you remember communion times with the Lord in the last 10 years? And we all reflected on those times we communed with the Lord, and we couldn't imagine that we could remember that far back. I recalled an event that happened 25 years ago when I was in God's Word communing with, it will never leave you, and it's the better decision. So we've learned that there is good things, but there's better decisions. And then we said from Luke chapter 10 through Luke chapter 19, and you'll notice we're in Luke 12 here, and between Luke 10 and 19, we said that for the next 6 months, Jesus starts teaching them and teaching them. They've been with him 3 years, and he's going to go to the cross in 6 months. And so miracles kind of take a backseat where his teachings are more profound and more powerful, and he's wanting to prepare them for life when he's physically not with them. Then last week, we went to Mark chapter 9, which was about at the three-month mark right before the cross, so in his teaching period, and we noticed that the disciples had the power to cast out demons and illness and heal all manner of sickness and disease, but when this father came to them and said, "Can you heal my son?" they couldn't, and the Lord said, this comes through nothing but prayer. And so he said that you had the power to do it, you had the capacity to do it, and they said, why couldn't we do it? We actually imagined that moment of how they tried to cast that demon out and they just couldn't, and how embarrassing that was. And he said that you have been given the ability, and you have been, and we researched the scriptures that said you were able to heal people before. And we read those moments where they were able to heal before, but when it came here, they were unable to. And that just shows you that just because the Lord has given you the capacity to see his spiritual power and your resurrection power, you must appropriate it throughout the day. It's not just I'm a child of God, so I have all this power. Being controlled with the Spirit is communing with him. And we noticed that nine of the disciples were powerless, but three of them had just gotten off down the mountain having a wonderful worship experience with the Lord, seeing the glimpse of glory on the Mount of Transfiguration, and they were not powerless, but they had seen their disciples that hadn't had the worship experience. So in their busyness, they got consumed with doing and didn't realize that they hadn't communed and hadn't prayed and inserted in their day in order to have spiritual power. So it's today, this is such a beautiful, appropriate passage, because this is Luke chapter 12, which means it's within the six-month period of Jesus' teaching. And so you'll find in this instance that Jesus can't get away from the crowds because this is the last 6 months. He's popular. So whenever you see the disciples, people are around. Whenever you see Jesus, masses are around. In fact, in Luke 12, it starts the chapter with thousands are around, and it actually says that in verse 1, it says that people are tripping over each other. So there's a big, big crowd. But Jesus' goal, remember, is to teach his disciples before he goes to the cross. So there is no miracle in this account. But it's really interesting, his advice is how to remain spiritually strong and how to have the right perspective as you're going through life. And this is really interesting that he's going to tell them to admire creation. As you remember, we're not adding additional agenda items to your busyness. Yes, you could take on another Bible study to be spiritually strong, but that just adds another agenda item and it requires you to stay up even more time. You can add Bible studies, that's great, but the Lord's goal was to say, as you go, have a perspective that fuels you spiritually so that you can go through your busyness. Don't add 5-10 more agenda items, but go through your day. So he's going to tell them that as you walk on this earth and as we are walking around and traveling, and they're zigzagging all over Jerusalem and Israel right now, he's saying, I want you to keep your eyes open for something. I want you to look at God's creation. I want you to look at its beauty. I want you to look at how they're caring for their young. I want you to look at the birds, look at the flowers. I want you to look at the grass in a moment. I want you to look at a couple things he'll point out. And he'll say, I want you to see two things in creation. And I really, that is the message for us today. As we go through our week, open your eyes to, as you drive, as you walk, if you're a runner, if you like early morning walks, I know one guy likes, I talked to a guy last night, he gets up at 4:30, God bless him. I used to do that, and that's no longer happening. And then and by the way, I don't know, I'm 51, and I'm going to be jumping on this stage acting like a 20, watch me pull a hamstring tonight. So I get it. I'm embraced my fallibility, but maybe you're early, maybe you like late nights, but as you go, as you walk, as you look into the stars, just think two things. One, think of how amazingly intricate it is, how beautiful creation is. And then remember that you are more valuable than everything you see. Look at how intricate and beautiful creation is. He's going to say, look at the intricacies of a flower in a moment. Look at all the creation. In Genesis chapter 1, it says that he said everything was good that he made. And then when he created mankind in his image, he said, man is very good. Don't just look at the beauty and the intricacy. Look at that. Look at the power of God. And then look at the preference of God. I prefer, God says in Scripture, you over anything. So you're like, wow. So why am I stressing over care for me and my family? Because probably on that car ride, when we're admiring creation, we're probably working and consumed, and that's why you'll see the word worry over 3 times in this passage. Worry, anxious, anxiety. I'm probably on my car on the way to work, anxious if God's going to provide, and anxious if I can meet, if he'll meet my needs, and anxious about me trying to run the rat race. And he'll say, that's what the unbelieving world does. Don't act like that, because you have something different. You have a heavenly Father that actually takes care of everything around you. And if you are the most valuable creation in the world, you ought to know that if I can feed unclean, unacceptable birds and grass that gets burned in a fire to kindle it here and there, you know that if I've made that level of commitment to weeds, then I've certainly got you in my hand. And as we go through this hurry and this rush, we remember that God has got me. He's also going to encourage us in this passage that while the scriptures will say it's honorable to work, and in fact, scripture never dogs people with possessions. In fact, 1 Timothy 1 or 1 Timothy 6, it actually says too, for those that have possessions, you have then more to further the ministry. There's nothing wrong with possessions, but he's going to say, we self-inflict this anxiety and add to the hurry and the worry by self-inflicting that we get consumed with our work and consumed with what we're doing, and we work as if we are God ourselves. We say it's my battle to provide for myself, and he's going to say working is fine, but being consumed with having to run the rat race, he says, you will experience this level of anxiety. And he'll say, anxiety cannot add one itty bitty moment to your life. In fact, anxiety can change the quality of your life and never for the better. And he's going to encourage us to work hard, but always find that balance of saying, am I foregoing the wonderful creations and blessings of God because I feel I have to do it all on my own? And he's going to encourage us to be balanced here. And he's going to encourage us to lighten up the load of the anxiety of feeling like I have to provide for my family all by myself. There is always in a believer's life that God factor and says, God, I will work hard, but I will not compromise my beautiful creations at home. And I will not forego those times of worship during my day. For when you're consumed with your work and when you're worried about everything, you forget to look around you that God's got you, and you start to realize that I'm doing God's job. You know, Psalm 131, it's three verses. It's the most beautiful psalm that talks about getting rid of stress in your life. It says, I don't do three things. David describes himself as a peaceful man. The third thing is, I don't try, quote, things that are too wonderful for me. And that is a phrase in the Old Testament that is used of God-sized miracles. And when a person realizes, I will work hard, but I need to just realize that God's got me and God's got my family and he's given me beautiful creation all around me and beautiful creation at home, I need to make sure that I'm balanced and I need to make sure that I'm not totally focused on doing all this providing thing all by myself as if there's no God element here. Because if I'm a child of God, God's commitment to me is greater than grass and the birds and flowers, and it's a beautiful, beautiful story. When my daughters were growing up, Father's Day, we had a wonderful time where, you know, when you have nothing, you don't know you don't have nothing, and one of our most favorite times was to enjoy each other, and I vowed I would never get so consumed to where I would miss out on the creation all around me and the beautiful creations at home, my wife and daughter. At the time, it was just Lauren. And we had this little tradition. It didn't cost anything, by the way. That's always good. We'd have dinner at home, and then we would sit in front of a fireplace, and it was a natural fireplace. It wasn't fed by gas or anything. And so I would get one of these starter logs because I couldn't start a fire. I mean, I'm just not a Boy Scout, trust me. So I just know to light this corner and this corner of the paper, and there it goes. And then we would shave ice chips from our refrigerator in a red cup, and all three of us would sit on the couch and admire the fire. And we would put Nat King Cole, Starlight, right there, volume 3. I just never forget. And all we would do is sit there. And we'd loop the song. So we've sung the song 1,000 times and just kind of listened to it. And Lauren was kind of gaga goo goo, so, you know, we would just talk with her. She heard a lot of profound things, but never quite grasped it. But when she could grasp a cup, she would just sit there and she would, you know, get one, miss five, you know, and just kind of put these ice chips in her mouth. And when I knew it was time to go to bed, it was when I felt this thud on my shoulder, and it was just Lauren going, and she'd hit my shoulder, and then we'd conk out. And that was it. Then Emma came along, and it's really interesting the discussions change, which, by the way, I want to encourage you fathers, way to go for having communications and talking with your children. When I have learned that if you want a great relationship with your children, obviously at this age, Lauren being 21, Emma 18, you have committed to having that relationship with them early on. And so when they got a little older, you know, questions like why are frogs green, why do bees buzz, and you just make up an answer. The best answer is God made it that way. That helps. But you entertain because those are big in their world. They've been thinking about that. And so when they got older, I began to receive questions like, who do you love more? Now, where do we go with that one? Who do you love more? I'm your favorite daughter, you know, and they kind of smile and all that. I'm your favorite. Who's your favorite daughter? Well, you're my favorite firstborn. And you're my favorite 18-year-old. You know, you're my favorite baby of the family. So, you know, you find some characteristic. And, of course, we love you all the same, and that's how we instill them. But in this passage, our Heavenly Father says it's okay to admit, as you drive in His creation, it's okay to say, beautiful sky, God loves me more. Beautiful flowers, my Creator loves me more. Beautiful birds, beautiful animals. There's something on TikTok right now where this bear was in Florida and he came out of a beach. And I'm like, wow, that is crazy creation right there. How does that happen? And you think, wow, there's so many intricacies. But no matter what the beauty, God loves you more. And He wants you to believe that and to say that in your heart when you're driving through His creation. Luke chapter 12 wants you and I to know that as we go through life, He loves us more. And if He's committed to the birds, He is committed to us more. That's why we can cast our care on Him, because He cares for us. So in the busyness of your life, two things. One, drive around, look at creation, and know that He is powerful. But two, don't ever forget His preference. He loves you more. And if He's taking care of the world, like Colossians 1:17 says, that in Christ, in the Creator, He holds all things together. Everything in His creation, He holds all together. Thus, likewise, He is holding you in His hand. And as you go through this hurry, and if you're trying to provide all on yourself, just go, no, my God has promised that if I'm His child, as David says, I will never be begging for bread. So knowing the context, here's the beautiful passage. Luke 12, verse 22. Then turning to His disciples, Jesus said, that is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life. Stop right there. Something happened, you noticed. Right there, He turns to His disciples. So what happened before this moment? This discussion with Jesus' disciples is happening as a result of somebody interrupting His conversation. If you go back in your mind to Luke chapter 12 at the beginning, it says that He is, in this 6-month period of teaching, He is talking to His disciples, and in Luke 12 at the beginning, it says that He's talking only with His disciples. Now, there's a big crowd there, but He's saying, guys, I want you to, He's in a crowd, but He's talking to His disciples, and He's kind of taking them behind the curtain, so to speak, and going, look, time is short, so let's talk about what matters. Listen, you do everything to the glory of God. You do not be like the Pharisees, and He's teaching them like that. And then around verse 5, He says, I want you to know, never forget that you are more important than sparrows. How much could you buy sparrows for, like 5 cubits, 5 farthings? You are more valuable than sparrows. And all of a sudden, this guy interrupts him and says, Jesus, can you tell this my brother to split our inheritance with me? And it split. Right in Luke 12, He's talking to His disciples, you are more valuable than sparrows. And then here comes this guy and says, please tell my brother to split the estate with me. And so he's used to interruptions. So he turns to this guy and he goes, why do you store things in heaven? If your whole heart is focused on and consumed with making money, you don't fear the one that controls it all. And so he goes, hold on, guys. And he says, I need to tell you a story. And he tells a story about a man who says, there's going to be this time period. And he goes, I can build up grains and harvest. And he goes, I'm going to tear down barns and build bigger barns. And I can do this. And he says, the problem is with that guy that very night his life was taken from him. So where did all of his riches go? In the hands of somewhere else. And he says, you don't fear the one who is in control. You're loving his gift, his provisions, but not the protector himself. And you're what he called him a rich fool. And then he turns back to his disciples and picks up right here. Turning to his disciples, he said, see, that's why, guys, I tell you not to worry about everyday life. Whether you have enough food to eat or enough clothes to wear, for life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. Meaning it's not bad to have these, but this is all about being consumed with these possessions, wanting to just totally be focused on them. Let me read for you a passage. This is Proverbs 23, verse 4. 23, 4. Don't worry yourself. Don't wear yourself out trying to get rich. Be wise enough to know when to quit. Be balanced. In the blink of an eye, wealth disappears, for it will sprout wings and fly away like the eagle. In Luke chapter 18, it's no surprise that he engages a rich young ruler who says in Luke 18, verse 24, Jesus said, verse 23, the man heard that he had to give up his riches, and the man became very sad because he has amassed much riches. And Jesus said, it is hard for someone who is so consumed with pursuing wealth and driving right by the kingdom of God and driving right by his creation and forgetting who the giver of those wealth is, because your Father will provide your needs. Then verse 26, it says, well, who can be saved then? And Jesus says, it's not impossible for anyone to be saved. For God, nothing is impossible. But listen to Ecclesiastes. This is a very interesting passage. In Ecclesiastes chapter 2, it really has this focus on pursuing wealth. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 3. Solomon, after much thought, you'll hear Solomon referred to in a moment. After much thought, Solomon says, I decided to cheer myself up with wine, and while I was still seeking wisdom, I clutched at foolishness. In this way, I tried to experience the only happiness most people found during a brief life in this world. I tried to find meanings with building huge homes for myself, by planting beautiful vineyards. I made gardens and parks, filling all of them with all kinds of fruit trees. I built reservoirs to collect water to irrigate my flourishing groves. I brought slaves and men and women, and they were born into my household. I also owned large herds and flocks, more than any kings would have ever lived in Jerusalem before, verse 8. I collected great sums of silver and gold. He was on the rat race, the treasure of many kings and provinces. I hired wonderful singers, both men and women, and had beautiful concubines and everything a man could desire, Ecclesiastes 2:9. So I became greater than all who had lived in Jerusalem before me, and my wisdom never failed me. Anything I wanted, I could take. I consumed myself with pleasure. I found great pleasure in hard work. I consumed myself with the rewards of all my hard labor. But as I looked at everything, Ecclesiastes 2:11, as I looked at everything I had worked so hard to accomplish, I noticed it was all meaningless. Like chasing the wind, there was nothing really worthwhile around me anywhere. And Jesus is saying it is good to work. All of Scripture says it's good to work. But it says, for your life, verse 23, is more than just consuming your life for food and clothing. It is fleeting. And then he said, guys, I want you to look around. Keep your eyes open. You must know, as a good rabbi, he definitely points to visual aids. So he points to creation, verse 24. Look at the ravens. Some translations say bird. It's the word ravens. It's a term that just means it was kind of a pest, actually, in the first century. They didn't like these kinds of birds. It says they don't plant or harvest or store food in barns. There's that word barns from earlier in Luke 12. God feeds them. You are far more valuable to him than birds. I want to read for you what the scripture said about these particular birds. It isn't just birds. He didn't just go look at that beautiful robin or a bird that we admire. He picked the scrungiest, most despicable type of bird in their society, because in the Jewish mind, Leviticus 11:13, this bird was considered unclean. You couldn't touch it. Leviticus 11:13. These are birds that are detestable to you. Must never eat them. The vulture, the border vulture, it has all these different terms. Vultures, the kite, the falcons of any kinds, ravens of all kind. Deuteronomy 14, verse 11. You may not eat this bird. You can use these as ceremonial birds, but not these. You will not eat them. And it lists them again, every kind of raven. That's the very same thing. But then Job chapter 38, verse 41 says this, talking about these detestable birds in their mind. Who provides food for the ravens? When the raven's young cry out and wander for hunger, who feeds them? They immediately, in the Jewish mind, was reminded of Elijah, when Elijah predicted that it would not rain and there would be a famine for 3.5 years. 1 Kings chapter 17, Jesus, or the Lord, sent a raven to feed Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 1. Now Elijah, who was from Tishbe of Gilead and King Ahab, as surely the Lord God of Israel lives, God I serve, there will be no dew or rain for the next few years until I give the word. Verse 2. So the Lord said, go to the east, go to this brook near where it enters the Jordan River. Drink from the brook and eat what the ravens will drop to you. And every morning and every evening, you will be fed. In their historical prophets, they knew that these ravens were the ones that fed the prophet. They were unclean. The point is this. Even those detestable animals, I take care of them. The end of the verse. You are more valuable than any little bird. These were known for being angry birds in history, actually. Honestly, pun intended there. My dog is Albus. He is 7 pounds of total timidity. And we have a circle of blackbirds that look at him, and I think for dinner in the backyard. And they sit on that branch, and they circle, and they're just looking at. And it's funny, they haven't come near him because during Christmas, my daughters have decided, when they took him to the groomer and my wife, they said, would you dye his ears red and his tail red for Christmas? Well, when he came home, it was not red because the dye didn't work, and he became bright orange, like a Clemson mascot. And then the groomer said, well, maybe I can change it. She doubled down on a different dye, and it got even more orange. So now when Albus is out, these birds are like, what is that crazy meal? So they kind of, that helped. They kind of, but now he's kind of fading out, looks like a creamsicle now. And now they're getting interested again. But those birds fly away when I walk out there. The moment I step in his vicinity, they flee. You know why? Daddy's home. I have 2 daughters and a boy, by the way. Albus is his name. When I'm, and you know this, even in nature, when the owner comes near, there is this built-in fear because there is this protection and preference. And so they scatter and flee. God's saying, I even care for how their baby birds cry out for food. You have got to know that if you're going through life thinking it's all on your shoulders, don't fret about that. I even care for these mangy birds. And you got to know that I am ever present with you. Luke chapter 12, verse 25, can all of your worries add a single moment to your life? Some translations say, can it make you taller or make you grow? And some translations talk about life. It's a helixes is the term. It can either mean a time frame or stature. It's like saying, can you add just a little bit? And so some translations say just a little bit of time or just a little bit of height. That's why translations vary. Translations just say cubit and leave it at that. But can worry just add just a little bit of anything to your life? And if worry can't accomplish a little thing like that, what's the use of worrying over big things? Because God's got this. Verse 27. Now I want you to drive around. And I want you to look at the lilies. Look at the lilies. This term is krinon, and it means a flower in the grass. Lilies grew in the grass wild, but there were many flowers. This word was used of not just like a pretty Easter lily, but like of all kinds of flowers. In fact, in a moment, you'll see the word grass. Look at the lilies and how they grow. They don't work or make clothing, yet Solomon, this is in 1 Kings 4 and 1 Chronicles 9, yet Solomon in all of his glory was dressed as beautifully as they are, not as beautifully as they are. If you examine this, God cares so wonderfully about the flowers. Now, this is a different word than lilies. Lilies is the word krinon, which means kind of grassy flower. The word flowers here is actually the word kortos, which is the word for grass and flower. It's the word for the clustering of like wild field. Sometimes it has flowers. It doesn't mean lilies. It just means wild, that some grass kind of blossoms. And he's saying this is wild grass, and if you've seen it in Israel, it's all over the place. And if God cares so wonderfully for the flowering grass, he certainly will care for you. But look at how he describes the flowering grass. If God cares for such wonderfully for the flowering grass, this wild grass, by the way, it's here today and thrown in the fire tomorrow. What? He will certainly care for you. You say, well, why that description? Just like the birds, notice this grass. Let me describe this grass. Grass was used in the coal fires where they would heat up a meal, and if their fire was getting low, they would take grass that they had stored away and dried, and they would use it as kindling. And so this beautiful wild grass and flowers that would scan all over the mountaintops and would be so beautiful as they would walk around, and kids would like them. They were beautiful, but it was wild. And he says, that's the grass that they take, and then if they need to heat up their oven again, instead of going like 250, 354, they start putting just these clumps of this grass. And if he cares for them and their time is fleeting on earth, he will certainly care for you. Job chapter 8, verse 11, it says, while they are still flowering, not ready to be cut, they will wither more quickly like grass. The same happens to those who forget God. The hopes of the godless evaporate when they go into the fire. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 6, he says, this is what to shout to your people. People are like grass. Their beauty fades as quickly like flowers in the field. The grass withers, the flower fades beneath the breath of the Lord. The grass withers and is thrown into the fire. And he describes in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 24 and 25, it says that life is like flowers, and life is like the grass of the flowers, flowers of the grass. Literally, it was stuff that they would just kindle, light up a fire, and go. And he's saying, if something so beautiful, yet something so temporary, is just thrown in the fire, God cares for the flowers and cares for what gets consumed. And if you look at them really close, like a miracle of a child, you'll look at all of its intricacies. And if you examine verse 27, it close enough, you'll notice that it is more beautiful than the glorious rapport and the glorious clothing and the beauty of even Solomon. If you read 1 Kings 4, 1 Chronicles 9, if you really look at the intricacy of a flower, it is so beautiful. It does not toil. It does not spin in the field. It grows wild, and you look at the petal, and you look at all these intricacies and all the pollen and how it feeds, and then it just gets crumpled up in the fire. God has made a commitment to that creation, but you are more valuable than that. Verse 29, therefore, don't be concerned about what you eat. Don't be consumed about what you eat. Notice this phrase. Don't worry about such things. These things dominate your thoughts. Dominate the thoughts of unbelievers. Notice that. That is so very important. These kinds of things dominate the thoughts of people who do not know God. My goodness, Lord, I would never shame you. Yeah, but the real world, those that don't know God as their personal Lord and Savior, have nothing but their own effort to maintain their life. And those that don't know the Heavenly Father, the scriptures say they have no hope when they die, and it's so scary. They don't have a personal relationship with God. They don't know if they have peace with God. They don't know that their sin is forgiven. They know something's different and wrong and it needs to be clean, but they have no concept of how to cure it. And so it's all on their shoulders. So they have to worry about eating or drinking because it's dog eat dog. It's an evolutionary process. It's the stronger build the weaker and kill them, and it's all on your shoulders. So believer, if you have a heavenly creator that said, I created all of this, And it is so beautiful, but I love you more. You don't have to resemble those that have no hope. So don't be consumed like the unbelievers do all over the world. Because now notice this relationship. Because your heavenly Father already knows your needs. Verse 31, seek him, his kingdom above all else. He will give you everything you need. Look at just the love in these verses. Don't be afraid, my precious little flock. Such a beautiful analogy there of a flock that's scared and needs protection from the wolves and the lion. He calls us a little flock, for it gives your Father great happiness to give you the kingdom. That's why he says in Luke 11, give us this day our daily bread. God, I love you. I trust you. I love you. But I'm running like the world runs, as if you don't exist. And the Father says, look, work hard. On your drive, you're driving to a job that where you're working real hard. That's good. As the scriptures say, don't be lazy. It's always good to put your hand to the plow. Do it. Do it with all your might. Do it as a testimony to the Lord. But don't do it like you're all alone. And I'm afraid in our lives that sometimes we hurry. And this is the one level of worry that, guys, is self-inflicted. Dads, I get you want to provide. There's that providing bug in us. That's how God knitted us. But God, it's not totally on your shoulders. You can work hard and you could say, God will provide, and I pray as a child, he will speak to me through the Spirit to give me wisdom through this life on how to provide, on how to take care. And if I'm out of a job, I will pray to the end that he will provide, that he'll give me insight. I'll make sure that I'm honorable, living honorably to him. And I know God will provide, but I've never seen the righteous beg for bread, the scriptures say, because my Father loves me. Psalm 37, verse 23. The Lord directs the step of the godly. He delights in every detail of their lives. Though they stumble, they will never fall. The Lord holds them by the hand. Once I was young and now I'm old. Yet I have never seen the godly abandoned or the children begging for bread. Psalm 147, verse 2. He heals the brokenhearted. He bandages their wounds. He counts the stars and calls them by name, creation. How great is our Lord. His power is absolute, the psalmist looks at creation. His understanding is beyond comprehension. But the Lord supports the humble. Sing out thanks to the Lord. Sing praises to him. He covers the heaven and the clouds and provides rain for the earth. His creation is great. He makes grass to grow and the pastures on the mountains. He gives food for wild animals. He feeds the young ravens when they cry. He takes no pleasure in people that consider human strength above him. The Lord delights in his children who fear him. Psalm chapter 8, verse 3. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars as I drive my car down the road, you set in place. What are mere mortals that you should think of them? Human beings that you should care for them. But you made us a little lower than the angels. You crowned us with glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority. The flocks and the herds and the wild animals are under human beings. The birds of the sky are under the human beings. The fish in the sea and everything that swims across the ocean. Oh, Lord, you are majestic and your love for me is great. So the Lord says, why are you so anxious in your hurry? Because when you're in your hurry, you forget about me. What don't you trust about me? My love, my care, my compassion, my power, my preference. Do you not know that when I breathed life into all creation, I was waiting up for the day, the last day of creation, for you to come on the scene? so that you and I would have this intimate relationship that no other element of creation ever had, for you to be able to manage all of creation, to enjoy creation. What is it about me that you don't trust? Have I not demonstrated my love for you is so great? For I came on this world to live a perfect life, to enter my creation, to hug your necks, to love on you, to show you the way of salvation. I took all of your sin, bore it on the cross. 3 days later, I rose again, and I promised you that where I am, there you may be also. I'm coming again for you. I'm thinking about you. I'm protecting you. I saved you. And as long as you are my child, I will take care of you. Because you are my creation. I love you. So we join with creation and shout and praise him. He is worthy of praise. The rocks will cry out, but the Lord would rather hear it from us. You are the most beautiful creation of God. And fathers, as you train your children and point them to Christ, there is no other source and say, you can follow me as I follow Christ. I will do my best to exhibit the love and the protection of God. But there will come a day where we sit on that couch with nothing more than ice chips and a fire in the fireplace. And we're just going to say, I don't know what God's doing, but my God promises me that he will take care of us. He will provide for us. He is my creator. And we must praise him, and we can't worry about our Father who cares for us. Let's praise him this morning.
Let praise be a weapon that comes.
Lord, I pray over our precious people, everyone listening, Lord, that we would no longer worry. We would no longer worry about what you've already promised you would care for us about. Lord, you tell us to work hard, but we're in that car driving, forgetting to look around at your creation. You've made a commitment to the creation. You love us more. We have forgotten about your power of sustaining the world. Forgive us. And we've forgotten about your preference, that you prefer us above all. Lord, I pray that in our car rides this week, as we're going through the hurry of moving all around school and different schedules over the summer, even, Lord, in the car rides bringing our children here this week to Best Week Ever and home, may we listen to those wonderful cheers and those voices of our children who have loved their time with the Lord. And it may be loud in the car and we may be tired, but Lord, let us hear those as praises of your creation, reminding us that you love us more than all. Lord, forgive us when we have consumed ourselves with providing and consumed ourselves with the rat race, as the unbelieving world says in Scripture. Lord, may we resemble children who have a heavenly Father upon whom we trust. And Lord, forgive us where we have inserted anxiety and worry into our own day. We have compounded the hurry and added stress and anxiety. Lord, when anxiety is there, it's evidence of a heart that feels out of control. Forgive us when we're trying to control the world you've already said you control. Every man, woman, boy, or girl, I pray we will go through our busyness with our eyes open, remembering creation. Tonight, Lord, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, I pray that as we work hard to minister to these children, we will worship you, seeing a room full of your creations, your beautiful children, who you value more than anything. Lord, open our eyes. May the hurry not be too anxious this week. We love you and we praise you this day. In Jesus' name, everybody said, let's praise him this morning. He truly is worthy of our praise. Amen. On behalf of the Grove family, I want to thank you so much for coming. We are so glad that you're here. We have a gift for you. We really do. If this is your first time, please just go to the Welcome Center. Tell them Pastor Ben sent you. That's actually on behalf of our whole church. We'd love to give you that gift. It's a great gift. Trust me. We usually don't decorate this way, but I hope you like what we've done to the place. It is going to be wonderful all week long, 5:45, BWE, the doors open, and at 6:15, Downbeat, we are starting, and it's going to be a wonderful celebration. Pray for our kids that they will accept Christ, and they will fall in love with Jesus, and they will know they have a church that just, it's their church, folks. It isn't just their church this week, by the way. They own the place, I'll just tell you that. But this week, they're going to know, this is my church, and that they are loved by their pastor and all the people. Thank you so much for all of you that have volunteered to support the children as well. I want to encourage you on a couple things just real quick. You can even remain standing. This will just take a moment. We are so blessed to have a staff and a team. And by the way, on social media, reach out to Emily and Chad. Congratulate them. Baby Psalm is just a miracle from God, and we are so, so blessed. Reach out to them. We're great to have a staff. We're great to have some leaders. We're great to have small group leaders. We're so privileged to have deacons that are what we call lead servants of the church, and we are so, so grateful. This church is run and led by Spirit-controlled people. This church is filled with Spirit-controlled people. We say that our mission is to reach the world for Jesus, to show them his love, tell them his truth, and teach them his ways. And we do not apologize, because we want to reach the whole world for Jesus. And in order to do that, you must be led first by a pastor and a team and every single person that is Spirit-controlled. I am so grateful that our team is unified, humble, and selfless. And if you have sensed that in this church, I praise the Lord for that, because that's what we've committed to do. We have a board member who is leaving us. She's a wonderful woman, Robin Gwaltney. She's moving upstate. She is Dr. Robin Gwaltney with two young children and just a wonderful, wonderful individual that has come to Grove needing ministry when she first came a couple years ago. Loved the place and just fell in love with you, the Grove family. She hates that she has to go upstate because of her job and to leave her Grove family, but we thank Robin Gwaltney very much for serving on our board. And so next week, we will be voting on another board member. I'd like to introduce you to Mr. Gordon Fort. Gordon Fort, many of you know Gordon. Gordon and Leanne. Goodness, so many accolades. They've been at Grove for 18 years. They've pastored a country church in Texas for 10 years. They stayed throughout seminary there, and he met Leanne, who, by the way, you may think, yeah, we're hiring him to actually get Leanne. I'm just kidding. A year later, they went to Botswana in Africa to serve in the rural village for evangelism, discipleship, and church planting for 11 years. They came and accepted a leadership role to direct the work of some 350 missionaries in sub-Saharan Africa, including the Indian Ocean Islands, for 9 years. They were asked to move back to Richmond to take a role as a vice president for overseas operations for the International Mission Board, the IMB. And they got involved in a Bible study class. He became the senior vice president for prayer and mobilization. This man is a prayer. That's what our hearts really were drawn to. For prayer and mobilization and training to address the needs for raising prayer support and awakening and awareness for the missions overseas. He currently serves as the senior ambassador for the president of the International Mission Board. We are so blessed that he is here. He has been married to Leanne for 40 years, 4 children, 5 grandchildren, and the board unanimously recommended that we ask the church to approve him next week as our to fill the board position of Dr. Robin Gwaltney. So for all of you that love bureaucracy, let me show you a sentence from our bylaws. And by the way, if you have insomnia, reading bylaws is the cure for insomnia. Just pull out, it does the trick. So Article 8, Section 3, this is a special meeting. So a special meeting may be called by the church moderator, that's me, by the way, providing a public written or verbal notice, which is right now, not less than 1 week, to explain what the purpose of the meeting is, and we've made it public. So next week, right after the service, we'll simply ask for a yay, nay vote if we would feel within our spirits to have this wonderful brother in Christ support the leadership team of this church beginning next Sunday. So Gordon, if you would, just raise your hand there. Just wave it there, as some people may not know, but God bless you. Thank you, brother, for being willing. And we appreciate that. And also, I want to encourage you, we have new members getting involved. I want to show you Matt Sutton and Ashton Sutton, their family. In September, Matt and Ashton are beginning a small group for young couples, either without kids or maybe if you're engaged or if you're thinking about it or even with young children. We thought we'd start it in June, but what a testimony. They obviously saw our need to support the children's ministry during the summer. They postponed their small group, and right now they are serving and ministering to our kids at the 11 o'clock hour. We have their efforts covered in the fall. So beginning in the fall, they are starting a small group. Well, the deacon board unanimously this past week or week ago just prayed over him, heard his testimony. We prayerfully deliberated, and unanimously the deacon board has voted him as Yet Grove's additional deacon. So we thank you to Matt and new members. Hey, you don't have to be here 50 years to get involved. If you, this is your church, you let us know where you want to serve, and we'll prayerfully look at that, and I'm so glad. Grove family, I believe God's going to do a miracle this week. You pray for us if you're not here, and if you're here, you jump in, because we're praying for miracles that these kids become giants of the faith. And if we lose our voices, we're going to lose it for a good cause, shouting the fact that God's way is the best way, and Jesus is the only way to salvation. So you pray for us this week. Starts tonight. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you next week.